baptism. And I hope that you will begin to pray as we begin this service, that God will bless as we observe this baptism, and that our hearts will be flooded with our memory of following the Lord in baptism. But you pray for this one who comes, and we're trusting the Lord to bless as we worship Him today. Here we go. Right there. Ready? Okay. This is Carly Parks. Carly has come professing her faith in Jesus, and now to follow Him in believer's baptism and to walk with Him as her life begins anew and to move forward for the glory of the Lord. So in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and because of your profession of faith in Him, I baptize you, my sister Carly, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ in the likeness of His death. And we're raised to walk in newness of life.
Amen. Always wonderful to be able to witness a new believer's baptism. Let's sing together. There is power in the blood.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus or me? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
Wasn't that a great sight?
Amen.
We are glad you're here. We welcome you to the service and thank you for being a part of us. Thank you for sharing this time with us on this Lord's Day. We've got some folks we need to pray for as we pray for the service this morning. But there are several in our church that are sick, and I know that there's a lot that are sick with a lot of other things, upper respiratory things. So you want to pray that God will bless us. But remember Vi Smoke. Vi is recovering from hip surgery. She's in Amarillo. So you may remember to pray for her. Estelle Malone had an infection this past week. She is in Pampa Nursing Center for rehab. So you remember her. Kathy Black, this is Peggy Williams' daughter. Kathy had surgery last Sunday, and she's had some difficult times, but improves a little bit every day. So you keep Kathy in your prayers and remember her. Pray for Troy Hester. Troy's in rehab. He's still having a problem with the fluid buildup. You ask the Lord to bless and him and strengthen him. And then Donna Presley. Donna got some good news, but we still need to follow up. She needs a stent instead of heart surgery, which is a blessing. So you pray for Donna and you remember her and John and the family and ask God to bless them. So many others that are on our hearts. I know that are on your hearts and you want to pray for them. But let's pray for these. Let's pray for the service that God will bless us as we serve him. So let's join our hearts together and let's pray. Father, what a great joy, Father, to be in your presence this morning for the privilege that we have through your son, Jesus, to bow before your throne. And Lord, we come with the names of these, Lord, who are hurting that we've mentioned here, for Vi and Estelle. Father, for your hand of healing and strength for them, for Kathy and for Troy. Lord, may you touch and bless them and Donna. Lord, we pray that you would open the doctor's hearts and, Lord, that they would proceed with what she needs done. So, Lord, may you heal and strengthen all of these. And Lord, may you bless them in a very special way. And Lord, there's others of our church that are home and dealing with sickness. And Father, we pray that you would touch and bless them in a very special way. Lord, thank you for those who have gathered here to worship, for those that are listening by radio. We ask, Lord, your blessings in every heart and every life. And now, Father, we pray that you bless us as we worship. Father, that you speak to us through every song. Lord, that you bless us as we fellowship, that you bless our worship of giving. But Lord, as we open your word, we pray that Christ would be glorified. And Father, we ask that as we lift him up to you, Father, that you would move in the hearts and lives of your people. Lord, we thank you for how you're going to change hearts today. Lord, we commit this service to you. May the power of your spirit flow mightily among us. And Lord, may we feel and know your presence, your power, your grace, and your love. Thank you, Father, for loving us through your son, Jesus, for it's in his name we pray. Amen. If you're our guest today, we welcome you. On the inside of your worship folders, a little portion says, "Welcome to Central Baptist Church." Fill that out, put in the offering plate, write down. Let's all stand, greet somebody in the name of the Lord.
Your neighbor with a smile. Let's go.
I'll be seated. His amazing grace and all that he's done for us. Amen. Let's sing together, "How Great Is Our God."
Father, thank you. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for being here amongst us as we worship you, Lord. Just bless us today. May everything we do just lift you up and bring glory to you, Father. We pray for those who are sick, Lord. We pray for those who are struggling. But Lord, just give us boldness to go out and spread the good news, tell people about Jesus and about Central Baptist Church. Bless us today as we worship, Lord, as we take this offering. Just bless the gift and the giver, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take your Bible and join me this morning. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. We have entered a new year. And this is my first time here in this new year. I appreciate Jeff Messer and Tim. I know that you were blessed by them. I appreciate Andy and Sharon and Mary and Tim, they had everything under control. They told me everything's wonderful and fine, and they didn't need me, and I started to go back. But I'm glad you're here this morning. All of us heard a week or so ago all of the uproar about Happy New Year, resolutions, all of those things. You know, Americans really think that they're the ones that come up with that idea. Americans were the ones that came up with the idea, let's all get drunk on this day. Actually, historians tell us that the Babylonians used to celebrate New Year. And they even had resolutions that they made. And their resolutions were pretty much centered around returning farming equipment. But we all make resolutions of some kind or the other. And you might have made a resolution. I heard a physical trainer, a personal trainer, say the other, it's a week or so ago. He was asked, how long do these resolutions last? When somebody says, I'm going to come and lose weight, and I'm going to get fit, and this, and this, and this. And he said, 2 weeks in. And they're gone. 2 weeks in. Which is tomorrow. How many of you made a resolution? How many of you aren't going to admit I made a resolution? Somewhere inside of us, we do this. And we resolve to do certain things. The problem is that many of our resolutions are nothing but wishes. I wish I could get fit. I wish I could lose weight. I wish that I could do this. I wish I could do that. And it all boils down to nothing but just wishing. But it's not a passion. If it was a passion, we'd follow through with it. It's not a passion. It's something that we wish for. And when it doesn't happen to us just overnight, then we lose it. A passion is something that we need in our life to make sure that we focus our attention on that which is going to bring life to us. There's a writer, great biblical scholar, actually William Barclay. Many of you will recognize the name. But William Barclay said this, "A man will never become outstandingly good at anything unless that thing is his ruling passion. There must be something of which he can say, 'For me to live is this.'" So let me ask you a question. What is your passion today? Not resolution. I could care less about resolutions. What is your passion? Now, to many, the passion is your job. Of course, you reach a point where you say, "I wish I didn't do this," and da 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 da. I understand all that. But we wrap our life in something that is going to last for about this long in eternity, and then it ends. And then what does your passion become? There are some people that when that happens, they have nothing to do because they don't know anything else except that. So let me ask you again, what is your passion? What is the passion that you have that is going to bring you life? What is it that you actually live for? Have you ever thought about what is it that drives me? Now, I hear people talking about all the time that this world is all we have. And it doesn't make any difference what we do because we're all going to die and be thrown into a hole and then it'll all be over with and done. That's it. What use is this life if that's all there is? What would be a driving passion to a grave? Would we have a passion? I doubt. All we do is just stumble through this world until we finally quit breathing. Then we lay down, they roll us in a hole, and that's it. What is the passion that drives you today? Could be entertainment. Could be luxury. Could be recreation. Could be possessions. Job. Family. All of these things are temporal. What kind of passion do we have when it comes to our families and our lives facing eternity in the presence of God? Now, I think you know me well enough by now that I'm going to tell you, when we die, we will face Almighty God. We're going to stand before Him. You'll either stand at the judgment seat of Christ and be judged for your service, or you'll stand at the great white throne judgment of God and be judged for your sin. All right. Plain and simple. We allow things to rob us of the joy of life because we find that passion in something else. And in the church today, the church, I really believe, has been caught in Satan's snare. And here's what the snare is. Satan has convinced us that we must work for the Lord. Now, did you hear me? Satan said, that's his idea. Work for the Lord. Let me tell you what God says. God says, I don't want you working for me. I want you working with me. All right. Now, there's a difference there. Now, notice something here. When we work with God, we depend on God. Right. When we work for God, we become self-reliant. This is what I do. Look what I've done. This is what I'm doing. This is where I am. I've been in the church. I've done this. I've done that. I've done the other. On and on and on we go.
And Satan has ensnared us to that point that we forget about just exactly what he has, that God really has for us. But what is your passion today? What is the passion that is building the kingdom of God? What is the passion that you have that reflects on your family and does for your family more than it does for you? What kind of passion do you have? Is it leading your children to the kingdom of God? Is it leading your wife or your husband to the kingdom of God? Is it leading your friends and your neighbors to the kingdom of God? Is it leading other members of your family to the kingdom of God? I think there's some things that have happened in our world today that have robbed us of actually what we need in our life today. I need a passion. You need a passion. But our passion does not need to be limited to temporal. Our passion needs to fix on eternal. And if we lose sight of God in the midst of this passion, we're going to lose sight of what life is really all about, and we're going to drag others with us into this abyss that is going to rob us and take away all the joy of our life. Now, folks, I recognized over the last week that I've been here a long time. And I recognize sometimes that my voice and what I say gets lost because I've said it over and over again. I know that. I hear that. I see that. I recognize that. And then there could be someone else come along, say the very same thing, and we pick up on it. Oh, that's just great. That's wonderful. And I don't have a problem with that. I'm glad for that. But I want us today to just kind of stop for a moment and not focus on my voice and saying, okay, we're here for ever how long he gets wound up for, and then he'll turn us loose, and then we can be gone and be done with this, and then we can come back again. What I want you to do is hear what God has to say. As we think about this passion that you and I have for the kingdom of God. Because, folks, there is one resolution that you need to have a passion about. And it's found in verse 10 of Philippians chapter 3. Look at the first part of that verse and listen to what Paul said. And listen to these words. The first five words of the verse. That I may know him. That should be your driving passion. That I may know him. There's a difference in knowing him and knowing him. There's a difference to us when we think about what is this knowing God? You say, I know God. But actually what we mean is I know about God. I know that there is a God. I know about him. But do you know him? You always find those that are to this point of saying, I'm doing just fine. When I really need him, I'll call on him. Because I can make it through this world by myself. No, you cannot. You see, I got up this morning only by the grace of God. I ate breakfast only by the grace of God. I have a vehicle only by the grace of God. You got dressed only by the grace of God. Keep that in mind. God is the one that we live and move and have our being. And if it wasn't for God's mercy and grace that allowed you to do that, you don't have that. No matter how much you know and how strong you are, you cannot make it through this world without the grace of Almighty God. And we become so afraid of that. That we lose it and we lose sight of the passion of knowing him. So I want you to focus on that with me The passion that you and I need to begin in 2019, where we need to start, is that I may know Him. But look at the rest of the verse. That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection. And the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death. So what does it mean to know Him? Now, we've already talked about knowing Him here. That's not going to get you into heaven. It's here. Knowing Him here. But there's a problem with this. Because we think because we know Him here, maybe we've accepted Him as our Savior, or we say we have, that we think, okay, it's all done. Everything is done. C.S. Lewis, it was a great apologist that lived in England. He was an atheist, and God saved him, and he became a great writer for the glory of God. He wrote a book called Mere Christianity. And in that book, he describes the heart of the Christian life. And he mentions the fact that before you find Christ, that you have your own interest, your own desires, and you focus everything on them. As the Holy Spirit begins to work on you, then that begins to change, and all of a sudden, you find Christ. Now, when you find Christ, our mindset through Satan is this: because you have become a Christian, you've got to give up things. Now let me clarify something with you. When you find Christ as your Savior, you don't have to give up anything. But once you find Jesus, if it's against His Word and against His will, you want to give it up. I'm not going to do that anymore. But here's what we think. I find Christ. I have to give up some things. And then there's some things I have to add to this. And so we began. I began to go to church. I go for a little while. And then it's easier to miss, and then I miss another, and it's easier, and on we go. We read our Bible. I always get amused when people pick up the Word, and I say, "You're reading your Bible?" "Yes, I'm reading Revelation." "Get out of Revelation." Start with the Gospel of John. "In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. For God so loved the world, He gave us His only begotten Son." The Gospel of John is so easy to read, but it's so deep in what it has to say. So I begin to read the Bible, and all of a sudden I come across something I don't understand, and so I quit reading it, and then something a little more that I don't understand, and then we lose sight of reading the Bible. I begin to pray, but I don't pray like I used to anymore. I used to pray, but now I just pray when I really need to, or what I'm about to eat, or whatever. We have to give, we say. We have to give to God, so I give a little here and give a little there and give a little more here and there. I have to do some work in the church. They want me to do this, want me to take the offering, want me to do this, want me to do that, want me to do something else. And then all these other things that you have to add to that. Now, basically what happens is this, Lewis said. You and I begin to feel like that our hope is that when we do all of these Christian things, then we can be done with that and meet the demands that God has asked of us. And then we can go back to living our life like we want to live it. There's where the passion dies. Now we say, "I know Him." But yet the passion has died in us because we don't give that any other thought. We think we have met God's demands. God, He describes for us about what the Scripture says. And listen to these words of Lewis and what he said. Christ says, "Give me all. I don't want so much of your time and so much of your money and so much of your work. I want you. I have not come to torment your natural self, but to kill it. No half measures are any good. I don't want to be cut off a branch. I don't want to cut off a branch here and a branch there. I want to have the whole tree down. Hand over the whole natural self, all the desires which you think innocent as well as the ones you think wicked, the whole outfit. I will give you a new self instead. In fact, I will give you myself. My own will shall become yours." Lewis said, "This is far harder, way far harder and far easier. It is so hard to hand over our entire lives to Jesus, all our time, our money, our abilities, and our ambitions. Not just part of them so we can live as we like, but He wants all of them. The almost impossible thing is to hand over your whole self to Jesus. And that's where many of you are right now. You don't want to give Him everything about you. But He goes on to say, but it is far easier than what we are trying to do instead. We are trying to remain what we call ourselves, to keep our personal happiness and our great aim in life, yet at the same time, be good Christians. Lewis said this is why the real problem of Christianity comes where we do not usually look for it. At the very moment that you wake up in the morning, all of your wishes and hopes for the day rush at you like wild animals. The first job each morning consists simply in shoving them all back, in listening to that other voice, taking that other point of view, letting the other larger, stronger, quieter life of Jesus come flowing in, and so on all day long. Standing back from all our natural hopes and desires, coming in out of the wind, listening to Jesus. We can only do it for moments at first. But from these moments, a new life begins to spread through our system. Now we are letting Jesus work at our souls. It is a difference between paint, which is merely laid on the surface, and a dye or stain, which soaks right through. Jesus never talked in vague, idealistic terms. When He said, be perfect, He meant it. He meant that we must go in for the full treatment. It's hard, but that sort of compromise we are making is harder. In fact, it is impossible. Listen to this statement. It may be hard for an egg to turn into a bird. It would be even harder for it to learn to fly while remaining an egg. We are like eggs at present. And you cannot go on indefinitely being just an ordinary, decent egg. You must be hatched or go bad. This is the whole of Christianity. You must be hatched or go bad. So what does He say to us when He talks about what does it mean to know Him and what He said? Listen to what Paul said again in verse 10. And the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His suffering. What does it mean to know Him? It means that you and I have a passion for the glory of Christ in our life. And our desire becomes a sharing in His suffering. Sharing in the suffering of Christ brings to us the power of the resurrection. Now, it's interesting when we think about the resurrection and think about knowing Christ through the resurrection. But here's what you need to understand. The only one who can tell us and show us about the resurrection is Jesus Christ. He's the only one that's ever been resurrected. He's the only one that knows about it. It's a divine power of God that flows to us and comes to our life. He is our only example of the power of the resurrection, which means the power of the resurrection is available in Christ. So if you want to know Him in the power of the resurrection, renewing, bringing life to us, then you must come to Him and receive what He has promised to you. Now you receive the spiritual resurrection when you come to know Christ, when you're willing to confess your sin to Him, when you're willing to realize that you are absolutely nothing without Him, when you begin to understand that the life I'm living and the things that I'm doing are not going to bring me into the presence of God to live with Him for eternity. When we begin to understand that we're leading our families, or we're leading our neighbors, or we're leading others away from the kingdom of God, when we begin to do that, then we come in the power of the resurrection, and the power of the resurrection, as we know Christ, brings to us the death to life. We witnessed that just a moment ago. You can read it in Romans 6, verses 1 through 11. When we see someone who comes to follow the Lord in baptism, and you hear me say it, buried with Christ in the likeness of His death, raised to walk in newness of life. There, that spiritual resurrection has taken hold of us. And we know Him through that spiritual resurrection. This body which was dead, this person that was dead, has now come alive, and we are alive in Christ and the power of His resurrection. We receive a new life when we trust Christ. But It must progress. We change. We change morally. We change with our values. We change with our direction. We change within ourselves when we come to church. No longer are we just kind of inhibited and holding back. We don't want to sing. We don't want to worship. We don't want to do anything. We're just kind of there so that we can fulfill something that maybe has a hold of us on the inside. And you can say, well, I've been to church. Basically, one of the ways our life must change is scripturally. And scripturally means that you and I are willing to surrender to God. A week or so ago, we stood on the battleship Missouri. There's a space marked off right there where Douglas MacArthur sat and signed the treaty with the Japanese. The war was over. But it wasn't just a ceasefire. They surrendered to us. Pictures of all of the servicemen that were there signing this document. You see a picture of the document, and then here are the Japanese, and they come in and they sign the document. And it is surrender. You know what surrender is? You know what's different in a ceasefire and a surrender? When you cease fire, you hang on to your weapon. You just don't shoot it. When you surrender, you bring the winner your weapon. Now let me tell you something, folks. Many of you have called a ceasefire with God, and you've still got your weapon trying to use it and trying to do what you can do and be what you can be so that everybody can say, look at that guy. Look at that lady. She's got this weapon. Look at what she does. No, what God wants from us, He wants you to bring the weapons to Him and put on the whole armor of God. He'll fight the battle. That's what He wants. And our passion says, excuse me, I want the power of that resurrection. And that we are not complete in that until we stand in a glorified state with Christ. Now notice what he said. We share in his sufferings. Being conformed to his death. Isn't that what he said? And the fellowship of his sufferings. Being made conformable to his death. You say, gee, preacher, I can't do that. Yeah, you can. Basically what it means is this. It's a daily process. You die every day. I'm nothing without you, Lord. I can't make it through this day. I don't have any wisdom. I don't have anything. Lord, I'm absolutely nothing. Oh, God, I need you. I need your power. I die. I give you my life. What do you think a cross is? It's an instrument of death. And Jesus said time and again, take up your cross and follow me. Because when we die with Christ, we conform to him. Because when he died, it was in the will of God. When we die with him, we are living in God's will. Jesus died to self, just like he asked us to. You remember the Garden of Eden when he was there praying? Blood was dripping down his face. He was in such agony and intensity as he began to pray and say, oh God, if there's another way, take this from us. Oh God, if we can do this another way, Lord, just take this cup away. But not my will, but yours be done. And right there he died to himself because his passion was to bring glory to Almighty God and serve him. Our passion should be to remove ourselves and die to Christ and make sure that Christ is living in us. It is conforming to his death because death gives resurrection. And every day that you live, when you die to yourself, let me show you what's going to happen. He will resurrect you in that day to be everything he wants you to be. He will gift you and guide you and help you along the way. He'll bring you back to bed and you get up and you do the very same thing over and over and over again. That should be the passion of every born again child of God. To know him, the resurrection power, and conforming to his death. That's what it means. That's what it means to know him. But what does it mean? What do we do when we know him? As I sit and thought about this thing kept coming over and over to my mind. And here's the first thing. What do you do when we really have a passion to know Jesus. You ready? You've got to be honest with yourself. We're not. We don't like to admit those things. You remember when you got caught doing something growing up? I don't want to admit that. Even as we get older, there are things that happen in our life. And there are things that we let happen, things that we cause the consequences to. We don't like to admit those things. We don't like to admit that these things are happening in our life. So what are some of the things that we have to be honest about? And I'm saying to you this. What you do when you really know Christ is that I'm willing to be embarrassed so that I can know Him. That's honesty. I'm willing to be embarrassed so that I can know Him. So let me go back to what I said to you a moment ago about the trap that Satan has set for us. How many of you will be honest and say, I'm working for the Lord, but not with Him? I work for Him so that everybody can see what I'm doing. I work for Him so everybody can know. You know, I get accused a lot of being very private. Not saying a whole lot about what I do or whatever. And I am. I am. I don't know why. That's just me. But there are some things that come to us that we do, that we say. And we have to make sure that when these things begin to happen, and when we do this, we're honest with ourselves and we're saying, I want to work with the Lord. Because working for Him means I'm doing it. I'm not doing anything. I don't do anything except what I have here that God has implanted in my heart for over 50 years or nearly 50 years. This is what I'm supposed to do. I can't quit it. Be honest with yourself. Are you working for Him so others can see it? Or are you working with Him to give Him glory? Another thing. Let's be honest about something. What excuses do we use to not do what God has called us to do? What's our excuse? What excuses do we have to justify ourselves and say, that's just not for me. I can't do that. Now, we can fool other people. You can fool me. You can fool other people around you. But you're not fooling God. So what excuses are going on? Well, I've heard people say, well, you know, my kids, I just can't get them up and going, da-da-da-da-da-da. And I wouldn't say this, but I'm getting older, so I might one of these days. How about God just take those kids away from you, and then you have time? Good? No. Do you know some of our excuses are just exactly like that? And we make these excuses so that we don't have to do things for God in the church. Because we're not comfortable with that right now. And it's because we don't have a passion to really know Him. Because folks, I can remember the first time I preached. You're not going to believe this. It was just about 12 minutes. I've progressed from that day. But I am who I am. I didn't know. I didn't know how to do that. Still don't know how to do it very good. Started pastoring a church in 1983. I didn't know how to pastor a church. Still don't know very good. Learned a few things over the years. And don't sit there and tell me, well, I don't know. None of us know when we start. But how about God blessing us as we continue for Him? Here's another thing. Am I a servant blessing others? Or am I a burden on my ministry or the ministry of someone else? We can be burdens to others to tear them down. A spouse is trying to do things for the Lord and the other spouse doesn't want to do that and they drag them down. We can't do that. We've got to be a servant and serve together for the glory of God. Here's another. Be honest with yourself. Do you live in jealousy that brings about anger so that we begin to tear others down? And tear them down because we're jealous of something that they do or say or have, or on and on it goes. Jealousy is will rip the church apart. Jealousy will rip you apart. Jealousy will tear families apart. Jealousy will destroy us. And Lord, we can't have that happen to our lives. Now look back up with me at verse 2. Because I want to ask you one more question you have to be honest about. Beware of dogs, and he's talking about false teachers there. Beware of evil workers, beware of the concision. For we are the circumcision. These are the ones, the concision is those Judaizers that wanted to put other things with the salvation of Christ. For we are the circumcision. Paul's talking about the Christian. We have been circumcised by the Lord Jesus Christ, which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. So be honest with yourself. Am I really a counterfeit? Seeking to not build a kingdom? Or am I living every day to know Him? To be rid of those things that I've been depending on, to be everything that I have for me? Or am I just a counterfeit with a smile on my face where everybody thinks everything's okay? Here's what happens. We must honestly claim to be who we are and worship God. You see, when we honestly claim to be a Christian, then live that life. Because when you honestly have that in your life, then you worship God. That's what he said, which worship God in the Spirit. We've got this misconception about worship. Worship is when you stand up and sing. Worship is when music plays. Worship, that's part of worship. That's not all of worship. And worship is not the beat of the music. It is the presence of the power of Almighty God that we are seeking to make us what we need to be for Him. That's worship. And Andy agrees with me on that. We agree wholeheartedly on that. We've talked about that. Some people worship the beat of the music and say, oh, I'm worshiping. I can't do that because I missed the timing. Everybody's going this way and I'm going that way. Worship is bringing ourselves into the presence of Almighty God and seeking Him in my life and in your life. Being honest means not being obligated to be here. I have to be here because it's Sunday. No, you don't. I'm glad you are. But we don't have to come being obligated because we sit and drum our fingers until it's time to go home. We need to be here because it is a joy to be in the presence of God with God's people. I want to be here. That is the passion. I want to be with my brothers and sisters. I want to give myself to the Lord. I want what God has for me. Corporately, privately, I want everything that God has. We must honestly not be afraid to brag about Jesus. Now, some of you go and you drink coffee and you go here and you go there and do different things. And it's a great deal. And I don't have any problem with that. But let me ask you something. Do you really and truly talk about Jesus? Are you ashamed to talk about Him? Are you ashamed to let other people know what He's done for you, what He's doing for you? Do you bring up the conversation about what God is doing in your life, what Jesus has done for you? We have to be honest about showing the death of Christ in our life. I want to know Him and I want to die just as He asked me to do, being confident in who I am. And we must honestly love one another. Folks, this business is saying, oh yeah, I love you. But yet in your heart, there are those things that we have that are against. We've got to learn to love one another. You see, that's what being honest is. But we must honestly seek to serve God wherever we can. There's a thing, you remember the seventh day? in the book of Genesis. You remember that? You remember the first 6 days, the first 5 days? He said evening and morning was the first day, and God saw that it was good. Day two, day three, day four, day five. God saw that it was good. The sixth day, he made man, and he said, it is very good. But then it says, the seventh day, it said, God rested. He did not say, it is good. Now, I read something this couple of weeks ago. And it said this, the English Standard Version of the Bible, and some of you may have that, the English Standard Version Study Bible says this about the seventh day. He says there is no closing refrain of it is good. And many conclude that the seventh day still continues. So, if that's the case, and I'm not saying I agree with that, I read it, and I want to use it to kind of open your mind a little bit. The seventh day continuing, God rested on that day, but he is still working. He is still involved. He is still with us until we get to Revelation 21, and he said, I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from heaven as a bride adorned for her husband. A new heaven, a new earth, a new Jerusalem. And when that day happens, God will say, it is good. Good. And he wants us to serve him because he's still working in our world and in our life to change us. If you read it in the middle verses here, beginning in verse 7 and 8, you find the Apostle Paul going to the garbage dump. How many of you remember when we used to go to the dump? Yeah, a lot of you went to the dump. Don't tell me. Some go to the dump to shoot rats. Used to be able to do that. Some go to the dump ground and see what they could find. Take it home with them. Take it to their wife and say, look what I bought you. I remember standing in downtown Shamrock and you look up and there's this big black smoke coming up. And somebody said, what's that? It's the dump. We set it on fire. Remember that? They used to burn this one out here. You just set it on fire. Let it burn. We can't do that anymore. We're too prim and proper for that. We mash it all into the ground where you don't want to get out when you get out there because it's nasty. Paul said, I'm going to the garbage dump and I'm unloading all this mess that is keeping me from being everything that God wants me to be. And I'm giving all of this trash and all of these things in the past, and I'm giving it to God, and I'm laying it right there, and I'm turning around, and I'm leaving the dump behind. Because I'm ready to know him, to live my life to the fullest, until, verse 20, for our way of life is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself, until the Lord comes again. That's what we do. What do we know when we know him? Let me just share a few things with you. We know we're saved. Now you sit there and you say, oh, I joined a church, but I'm not real sure about the other. If you haven't confessed your sins, ask Jesus to come into your heart and save you. And then follow him and begin to serve him. You got to change that today because you know that you're saved. We know we're secure. No one takes us out of the Father's hand. We know that he's called us his servers. We are to minister. That's what God said. We are sure. We're sure about who God is. We're sure about what God's going to do. We're sure about the work that we have in him. And then we are safe in him. I don't care what happens. Really don't. I'm going to live till I die, and so are you. And I'm not homesick yet, but I've got news for you. If God wants to drop me right now, I'm gone. And I'm gone to heaven. Can you say that? I'm ready to go to heaven. If you can't say it, you can in just a moment, because I'm going to give you a chance to come and find Jesus as your Savior. Because folks, you and I need to know Him. And Christian friend, I want you to ask yourself and be honest with yourself. Do you have a passion to know Him? To know Him in the power of His resurrection so that He can resurrect and empower you? Are you ashamed of Him that you want to just live one way among other people and live this way in the church? Are you so ashamed of Him that you can't do that? It's time to take a stand. 2019 is the year that you stand up and say, my passion is to know Jesus and be like Him. I don't know how He does it, but I'm going to surrender myself to Him every day, and I'm going to let God do His work. Would you let God do His work in your life today? Let's pray together.